My mission is simple, to make you money. I'm here to level the playing field for all investors. There's always a bull market somewhere, and I promise to help you find it. Mad Money starts now.
Cramer. Welcome to a special West Coast edition of Mad Money. Welcome to Cramerica. Other people want to make friends? I'm just trying to help you make some money. My job is not just to entertain, but to teach. So call me at 1-800-743-CNBC or tweet me at Jim Cramer. But here we go again. Back in San Francisco at our One Market Bureau after an almost two-year hiatus. Why come back here? It's simple. This is indeed the innovation capital of the world. And innovation drives the stock market. Innovation is what makes stocks go higher. If you want to know what the future looks like, you can't just hunker down on the East Coast. You need some sense of the future. When we teach you how to pick the right stocks for yourselves or imagine your portfolio like we do with the CNBC Investing Club. Now, on any given day, there might be themes that trump tech. Oh, that was true today. Dow slipped 13 points. S&P edged down fractionally. NASDAQ declined 0.04%. I mean, the week is the heart of retail season, right? I mean, retail earnings, does that have anything to do with tech? Well, wait a second. We hear from all the most important broadline and big box stores like Walmart or Target or Home Depot or Lowe's. But what really drives those stocks? What drives retail these days? The whole industry is going on all in on omnichannel, direct to consumer. In other words, tech. If you're running a store that's still using the old ways, trying to keep track of inventory by hand, trying to intuit what customers really want based on gut instinct, then you're toast. Retailers need the customer relations management software of Salesforce.com, the personal touch that Twilio can give you. By the way, Twilio's on tonight. And all of it's powered by high-speed computers that run on chips from Nvidia, AMD, Intel, the kind of chips you can see if you go into a CoreSite data center real estate investment trust. Yes, the one that was bought this morning by American Tower. Without these special tech accoutrements, well, you might as well fold up shop. And it's not just retail. When I got out of school, I went into banking, finding myself at Goldman Sachs. These days, if you're going into banking, that may mean working at a fintech firm like Square that's out here, Upstart, Robinhood, Affirm, another one that's on the show tonight. These places harness the power of artificial intelligence to disrupt entire industries, or they empower the individual versus institutions. So what am I personally looking for out here in Silicon Valley that I hope can make you some money? Number one, how businesses are using artificial intelligence to replace humans, especially because workers are so darn hard to find now that we're living through the Great Resignation. Do you know in September, just in September, we had 4.4 million people quit their job? That's 3% of the total. When you think of artificial intelligence, well, you know I got to come back to Nvidia. Everybody views this one as a semiconductor company, but it's really a platform for all sorts of artificial intelligence and machine learning. If you want to go to the next level of climate change measurement, or carbon capture, or stopping fires, developing new medicines, then you need speed. And humans simply can't calculate anywhere near as fast as computers. And the computers are a lot smarter than we are. Well, then there's conversational artificial intelligence. Artificial intelligence that lets computers come across like actual people. Well, that's Five9, the contact center software play that we'll speak to later in the show. And yes, ultimately you get to people, but you got to get to the other kind first. Second, there's the metaverse. When people hear this, well, of course, now they think of Facebook, the company that just changed its name to Meta Platforms. Mark Zuckerberg has committed $10 billion to build out his metaverse. That's more, by the way, than Iceland's doing. Personally, I prefer the picks and shovels place that will make all this possible. You know what that is? That's the U, Unity Software, not the university, although I like the university, which makes the tools you need to develop video games and now metaverse experiences. What's so appealing about this? I think Unity's technology can put you right in the middle of any football game, maybe playing center for the new improved Mahomes, or having cameras on all players so you can isolate the ones you care about most for your fantasy football team, which I better win tonight. By the way, mine's 1-2 in a row. Who gets to the metaverse first? Well, let's see. Who gets it? It's Roblox. They got up ahead of Facebook. They did. My money's on Roblox, the popular online gaming platform that makes it easier for users to create their own digital experiences. Now, if you go back to the interview we had last week with CEO Dave Baszucki, it's the Zook, not the other Zook, who's been developing an alternate universe for 15 years, just about 20 miles down the road, you'll realize, hey, maybe they invented it. Maybe Al Gore invented it. I don't know who invented it, but I like Roblox. But the most important player in the metaverse, it's a company I mentioned already, and it's indeed Nvidia. Not only do they dominate artificial intelligence, they also make the best graphics chips that can power virtual reality. I make no secret of how much I love this company. I wouldn't rename my dog Nvidia if I thought it was just a standard issue growth stock. Now, a lot of people freak out when they see that Nvidia's got a $750 billion valuation, because that's three times the size of the next largest semiconductor company. But like I said before, you can't pigeonhole this company as a mere chip maker. No, Nvidia is a creation company, creating the ability to have machine learning and artificial intelligence that can solve problems we didn't even know existed, while also making gaming and metaverse experiences more lifelike. I need you to do this. I need you to go watch visionary CEO Jensen Huang's GTC keynote from last week. It starts with a kitchen, okay? You don't know it's virtual. It's a beautiful kitchen. Then it's decomposed. And then it's gotten soaring, beautiful, classical music, except it's not classical at all. The composer is a computer, yet a machine. Sounds a lot better than the moderns. Third theme, electric vehicles. Rivian keeps exploding higher ever since it came public last week. They're based in California, but the South, not the North. Here in Silicon Valley, hey, we got Lucid. Yes, the luxury performance electric vehicle maker. It just won the Motor Trend Car of the Year award today. It's not even out, it got the Motor Trend. Wow, it could just be in your brain you get that. Well, we're going to see them tomorrow. Who doesn't want to be the next Tesla? Who doesn't want to own the stock of the next Tesla? And that is the real driver here. Fourth, how did financial technology become a West Coast obsession? I think it's a good thing because when the East Coast does financial innovation, we just invent ever more ridiculous types of securities that blow up in you. On the West Coast, they're more into engineering than financial engineering. You want a real revolutionary take on banking? You need to talk to the people who run Square, tomorrow's business. And you need to speak to Max Levchin from a firm who's reinvented the concept of buy now, pay later. He's trying to cut the credit card companies out of the consumer lending equivalent because, well, you know what? They've kept generations trapped into their financial chains. Which brings me to another concept, another reason we have to come out here. When I got out of school in the early 80s, my goal was simpatico with Wall Street. I wanted to make as much money as possible without breaking the law. That was the zeitgeist back then. We didn't care about collateral damage. The consensus was what's good for business is good for America, vice versa. At least among yuppies. If you had a cause you cared about, you could take your profits and donate them to that cause. But we now live in a very different world. These days, the smartest people come out to the West Coast. While many of them come here with what they call a purpose, at the end of the day, the winners are making a lot of money, way more than you'd make at Goldman Sachs. In the East, money is a force. In the West, it almost feels like some sort of weird byproduct, the way copper's a byproduct of gold mining. Is it really possible to make money and do good at the same time? I didn't used to think so. For most of my life, those two things seemed very unrelated at best. But the bottom line, the more I come out here, and I do need to come out here, the more I think it's true. You can do well by doing good. Maybe, just maybe, it's like Bob Dylan. I want to come out here because I was so much older then. I'm younger than that now.
Don't miss a second of Mad Money. Follow at Jim Cramer on Twitter. Have a question? Tweet Cramer, hashtag mad tweets. Send Jim an email to madmoney@cnbc.com or give us a call at 1-800-743-CNBC. Miss something? Head to madmoney.cnbc.com.
Shepard Smith here. Thanks for watching CNBC on YouTube.